Who was Simon of Samaria? In Acts 8, we learn that he was a sorcerer who claimed he himself was the great power of God before Philip came into the area and preached the gospel. The big question surrounding him was he ever saved or was he just a false convert as commonly taught? Most people think he was never saved. Is this the truth or just another myth and misrepresentation of the biblical record? Here are the facts. 1. Philip went by himself to Samaria and preached God's word there. 2. Philip preached about Christ and performed miraculous signs. The miracles caused the people to pay close attention to what he was saying. Acts chapter 8, 6-8 says, "When the crowds heard Philip and saw the miraculous signs he did, they all paid close attention to what he said. With shrieks, evil spirits came out of many, and many paralytics and cripples were healed. So there was great joy in the city." Did you notice that? Many crippled and paralyzed people were physically healed. 3. A sorcerer named Simon lived in that city. He boasted of himself that he was someone great. He also deceived the people with his magic to the place where it was commonly said, "This man is the divine power known as the Great Power." They followed him because he had amazed them for a long time with his magic. Before Philip came, the people in the area were longtime followers of Simon. 4. But all that attention and admiration of Simon that he had received came to a halt when Philip came into the area and the people got saved and water baptized. Acts chapter 8, 12-14 says this, "But when they believed Philip, as he preached the good news of the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Simon himself believed and was baptized. And he followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and miracles he saw." When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. 5. Simon also got saved and was Christian baptized. Again, the Bible states in Acts 8:13, "Simon himself believed and was baptized." 6. That ends the mystery about this man. He was clearly saved and water baptized, just like all the other men and women in that area that believed and were baptized. 7. There's even more scriptural evidence, though, that the Samaritans, because of the preaching of Philip, came to salvation. That evidence is Samaria had accepted the word of God, according to verse 14. We can be sure that accepted the word of God means people came to salvation because of the way that phrase is used in other scriptures, such as Acts 11 verse 1, where we read this, "The apostles and the brothers throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God." That passage refers to Cornelius, who clearly got salvation and baptism in Acts chapter 10, 43-48. Also, please know the Greek word translated received in Acts 8:14 and Acts 11 verse 1 can also be translated accepted. Hence, for one to receive or accept the word of God is another way of saying he came to salvation. The same language is found at other times also proving the same. For example, in Acts 17, 11 and 12, we read this, "Now the Bereans were more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true." Many of the Jews believed, as did a number of the prominent Greek women and many Greek men. In other words, the Bereans came to salvation because of Paul's teaching. One final example before we go back to Simon in Acts 8. Jesus taught in Luke 8:13, "Those on the rock are the ones who receive the word with joy, and when they hear it, they have no root. They believe for a while, but in time of testing, they fall away." In Jesus' teaching of the parable of the sower, the Lord taught there's a whole type of people that come to salvation for a while. That is, they believe for a while, then afterwards they stop believing and fall away or die spiritually. So with all these other scriptures, we can be sure the phrase accepted or received the word of God means came to salvation. Let's go back to Acts 8. Now that it has been shown in two clear and definite ways that Simon, like the rest of Samaria that heard Philip, had received salvation. After getting saved, they were water baptized, which can only follow a genuine conversion to Christianity. In Acts 8:14 through 17, we read, "When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. When they arrived, they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not yet come upon any of them. They had simply been baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Peter and John were sent to Samaria so they could receive the Holy Spirit through the laying on the apostles' hands. Philip never had this gift as Peter and John did. This all led to the following dialogue Simon had with Peter. When Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money and said, 'Give me also this ability so that everyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit.' Peter answered, 'May your money perish with you, because you thought you could buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord. Perhaps he will forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin.' Then Simon answered, 'Pray to the Lord for me so that nothing you have said may happen to me.' Acts chapter 8, 18 through 24. Simon wanted a gift that Philip never had, who stole the attention of Samaritans away from him when he arrived in the area and preached the gospel. Simon offered Peter and John money for that gift, which led to a stiff rebuke from Peter. Peter could identify him at that moment after his true conversion and salvation as being in a spiritually perishable condition, his heart not being right before God, and being full of bitterness and captive to sin. Peter told him to repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord. For Peter to tell him that shows, one, his future sins were not automatically forgiven, as the eternal security teachers want us to believe. Two, he was told to repent for salvation's sake after getting born again, because his heart was no longer right before God. He was advised to pray to God for himself and ask for mercy. Three, Peter did not hear his confession and pronounce penance on Simon as a Catholic priest might do from a confessional. This is important in showing that the Catholic Church has a false interpretation of John chapter 20, verse 23, their chief scripture used for confession to a priest. Four, Simon was captive to sin once again. At salvation, one is set free from their slavery to sin, but such a person can become captive to sin again, as shown here with Simon and in 2 Peter chapter 2, 20 through 22. Paul and Peter both wrote of this possibility occurring to saints in Romans 6:16 and 1 Peter 1:14 and warned them. Respectively, they said this: "Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one you obey? Whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness? As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance." With all this evidence, why then have so many been taught that Simon never had a true conversion of salvation when he definitely did? The answer is simple. Simon was saved through the preaching of Philip and afterwards was in a perishable condition again because of sin, then the prevalent teaching of once saved, always saved is shown to be false and of the devil. Folks, since there was no eternal security for Simon, Judas, the unnamed disciples in John 6:66, and many others, there isn't any for any Christian in our hour either. We must therefore remain on our spiritual guard, or we too will be back on the road to hell once again. As sin defiled Simon's heart, sin can defile your heart too. Remember Hebrews 12, verse 4. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. God bless you.
Evangelical Outreach is a no-compromise ministry dedicated to the proclamation and defense of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Will you join us in the fight and help us to win souls to Jesus? Call with your tax-deductible donation, 724-632-3210. That's 724-632-3210. ask for a free packet of ministry materials. Our mailing address is Evangelical Outreach, P.O. Box 265, Washington, P.A. 15301. That's Evangelical Outreach, P.O. Box 265, Washington, P.A. 15301. You will share in the fruit of our labors for the Lord. Thanks, and God bless you.